All of these are only his functional names which he attains as a result of identification with some portions of upadhi. Atma Teva Upasita. Who is he in reality? He is Atma. Apnoti the Atma. One who pervades all the roles and one who gains all the designations on account of identification with upadhi. One who therefore is one who pervades therefore all the roles as well as one who transcends the roles. In this manner Atma should be known. In short, what we mean by pervading and transcending is that in spite of performing all the roles, he does not in any way get tainted or affected by the roles. Which means that all the roles get played in his presence. Maya adhyakshena. So, in my adhyakshada, in my presence alone, all these things happen. So, prakriti suyate sacharacharam. The prakriti of matter so performs all its acts in my presence. And that's what is meant. In presence of the self, all these functions take place. Still we say that, who performs the functions? The Atma performs the functions. Which is the locus of ignorance? Atma is the locus of ignorance. Therefore, which is the locus of all the kriya and everything? Atma alone is. Therefore, we say that Atma is a seer, thinker and whatever. But is it really so? No. All of these roles, that he is even a locus of ignorance also is only due to the ignorance of superimposition. And therefore, all these roles are superimpositions upon the self. In this manner, may one know that in spite in that it is Atma or the self that performs all the roles, that in spite of performing the roles, that the self remains ever asangaha, associationless, advirya, non-dual. In this manner, the self should be known. Now, since upasita, since the expression is read, it mentions upasana, meditation. And also upasita, it is an imperative mood, which means injunction or instruction. So two things are there. It looks as though Upanishad is giving an injunction that this is a vidhi or an injunction that one should meditate upon the Atma. And secondly, that meditation upon Atma is necessary. So two things come out of this. Two kinds of objections are primarily there. One is from the grammatical construction of the statement, upasita, we say that this is an injunction pertaining to upasana or pertaining to knowledge upon Atma. So even if the word upasita is interpreted as knowledge, there is one paksha that says that this is an enjoyment or vidhi pertaining to knowledge. And then the other paksha says that this is the statement of upasana or some kind of a meditation over and above the knowledge. So understand that Vashyakara primarily takes up these two pakshas. We already discussed on the page 218 that this is an instruction or injunction vidhi pertaining to knowledge. Tishtadu tavat pakshiki atma upasana praptihi nityavayati apurva vidhi syat. Now this is a real purva paksha, apurva vidhi syat. We say that this is vidhi, purva vidhi is vidhi, it's an injunction. Jnana upasana yoho ekatvesati apraptatva. Because here Upanishad uses the word, two verbs, upasita and veda, we say that both of these words mean the same. Nasa veda iti vijnanam prasutya atmetya upasita di abhidanat veda upasana sabdayoho ekartata avagamyate. That having said that he does not know, and then it says he should know. So then he does not know, meaning knowledge is not something that obtains. And then it is said he should know. That means what one should know? That means that knowledge is something apraptam. Knowledge is something that doesn't obtain right now. And Upanishad says, one should know the Atma. Thus this is a vidhi or injunction pertaining to Atma, pertaining to knowledge. Anena khetat saram veda atmanam eva vedityadi shrutibhyascha vijnana upasanam. And then, anena khetat saram veda, this is a part of the same passage, atmanam eva ved, which comes later on, ityadi shrutibhyascha vijnana upasanam. We say that Vijnanam in knowledge is upasanam. So vijnanam and upasanam is the same. Knowledge and meditation are the same. Tasyati apraptatvat vidyarhatvam. And so this is a vidhi. This was the argument that was made here. Now we go to page 221. In fact, so far we came last year. And now we proceed further from the passage on the page 221. Then of course is Bhavanam Satra. I mean, it was further explained how Upasita. So grammatically also it is an imperative mood, and so it is instruction like Yajeta. And also, so when it is said Yajeta, one should perform the yaga. Automatically three kinds of questions arise. Kim yajeta, what is it that I should worship? Kena yajeta, with what materials should I worship? Katham yajeta, what is the manner in which I should worship? And similar to upasita, when it is said one should meditate, naturally the question arises as to what is it I should meditate upon? With the help of what should I meditate? And who should meditate? Or what is the manner in which I should meditate? And the Purabhakshi says that all these three are also answered here. Atmanaima upasita. See, we find here that whatever akanksha arises as a result of listening to a vidhivakya, that kind of an akanksha or a desire to know arises, expectation arises when we listen to this expression upasita. And whenever the Vedas says yajeta, they also provide the enough information to satisfy those expectations as to what should I worship and how should I worship and with what materials I should worship. Similarly, here also we find that the Upanishad provides sufficient information to provide to satisfy those expectations. What should I meditate upon? Atmanam eva upasita, may you meditate upon the self. Then kena upasita, with what should I meditate? Manasa upasita, may you meditate upon Atma in your mind. Katham upasita, in what manner should I meditate? It says tyaga brahmacharya shamadam uparati uparama tidikshadi iti kartavyada sanyuktaha ityadi. That you possessed of all these inner qualifications, so with a mind possessed of these inner qualifications, may you meditate. So we find that Upanishad provides answers to these three akanksha or expectations. Therefore we say that upasita should be a vidhi. Had it not been a vidhi, had it merely been a statement, there would be no need to give this information that we find Upanishad giving. So information that Upanishad provides is similar to information that Kamakanda provides to satisfy the expectations of the instruction yajeta. So we say the upasita also is a vidhi. Yathacha krishnasya darshapurnamasadi prakanasya darshapurnamasadi virudhasya uddeshyatvena upyogaha. Also we find that darshapurnamasabhyam, you know, so when it is said yajeta, one should perform the yaga called darshapurnamasa. Then the whole section merely is to fulfill the needs of this vidhi. So whenever an instruction is given, then enough background should be created, enough information must be given, enough direction must be given in order for one to fulfill that instruction or perform the instruction. So when we say that perform such and such task, naturally, I must provide all the information that is necessary to enable the person to perform that task. So here we say that just as the Karmakanda portion, when they give the vidhi with reference to performance of the yaga, namely darsha purnamasa, how the whole section serves the purpose, the whole section is in the form of the necessary information to serve the purpose of this vidhi or injunction, so that the one who listens to the injunction is able to perform the yaga. So also we find that in Upanishad, the main vakya is upasita, atmaname upasita, one should meditate upon the atma, and then rest of the information is given to enable one to perform that meditation. Evam, aupanishada, atma upasana prakanasya, ఆత్మోపాసన విధి ఉద్దేశత్వేనే ఉపయోగ. సో వి సే దట్ ఔపనిషద్ ఆత్మోపాసన ప్రకరణస్య దిస్ పర్టిక్యులర్ ప్రకరణ ఆర్ సెక్షన్ ఇన్ ఉపనిషత్ విచ్ పర్టైనింగ్ టు ది ఉపాసన అపాన్ ది ఆత్మ ఉపాసన విధి ఉద్దేశత్వేనే ఉపయోగ. That all the information provided in this Upanishad is pertinent to give all the data that is required to enable one to perform the upasana. So we said how? Asthula divakyanam aropita dvaita nishedat nishedhena advayam vastu samarpayatam katham upasana vidhi sheshatvam vidhi. In fact, when Upanishad says asthulam ananam akhrasvam adirgham, it's all negation, nisheda, nisheda. Atma is not this, not this, not this. So we ask them, that how can these statements, which actually negate all the qualifications in Atma, how can you ever say that these statements, which negate all the qualifications, serve the purpose of upasana? How? They said, neti neti asthulam ekameva dvitiyam ashanayadati tahitiyavamadi vakyanam ఉపాస్య ఆత్మస్వరూప విశేష సమర్పణ ఉపయోగ. ఆత్మానం ఉపాసిత వన్ షుడ్ మెడిటేట్ అపాన్ ఆత్మ. వాట్ నేచర్ ఆఫ్ ఆత్మ వన్ షుడ్ మెడిటేట్ అపాన్? అస్థూలం అనను ఏకమేవా ద్వితీయం అశనాయాది అతీత. సో ఆల్ ఆఫ్ దీస్ ఆర్ నథింగ్ బట్ గివింగ్ యూ ది ఇన్ఫర్మేషన్ అవర్ ఆత్మ సో దాట్ యూ కెన్ మెడిటేట్ అపాన్ ఆత్మ. దిస్ హౌ దే సే దాట్ బ్రహ్మవేద బ్రహ్మేవ భవతి తర్వి శోకమాత్మవిద ఇత్యాదీనా ఫలార్పకత్వేన ఉపాస్తి విధి ఉపయోగం. ఆల్సో ఇన్ ది ఆత్మ సో తర్వి శోకమాత్మవిద్ ద నోవర్ ఆఫ్ ది ఆత్మ క్రాసెస్ ద గ్రీఫ్ ఆర్ బ్రహ్మవేద బ్రహ్మైవ భవతి ద నోవర్ ఆఫ్ బ్రహ్మ బికమ్స్ బ్రహ్మ. సో దస్ దిస్ ఇస్ ఇట్ సేస్ దాట్ వి సే దాట్ ద నాలెడ్జ్ డైరెక్ట్లీ రిజల్ట్స్ ఇన్ టు మోక్ష. వెర్ ఇస్ ఉపాసన? దిస్ ఇస్ ఫలం చ మోక్ష అవిద్యా నివృత్తిర్వా. In fact, this phalarpakatvena upasthavidhi upayogam. So whenever you perform an action, you must always be told what will be the result of the action. And so all these passages are to show what is the result of the upasana. This depends on how your orientation is. So the orientation of the Purvapakshiya Mimamsaka is that you can accomplish something only when you do something. Just knowing something that you are Brahman, so what? That you are. If knowing that you are Brahman were sufficient, then without knowing also it is sufficient because you are Brahman. What difference does it make whether you know it or not? After all, the sugar is sweet. Whether you know it is sweet or not, if you eat, it is going to give you sweetness. So what does it matter whether you know that sugar is sweet or not? Because it will act according to its nature. And so also, if Atma were Brahman, then Atma is Brahman, whether you know it or not. And therefore, you are Brahman. And therefore, how does that information do anything to you? How does it add anything to you? Information about something that is existing does not do anything to you. It is when you do something, when you know that there is such a place called Timbuktu or Kashmir or whatever, that when you do something that you can enjoy what the place is about. And so merely knowledge doesn't do anything. Therefore, something must be done in order to convert that knowledge into practical lives. So there is a problem with the thing must be made practical. So all this knowledge, etc., all this you study, then you try to do, you do something about it so that these things become practical. It's all about scholarship. It's all scholarship. So scholarship must be done, you know, you must convert it into practicality. And therefore, you should meditate. So various hang-ups everybody has, you know. So this is a strong hang-up. That's some, you can't achieve something unless you do something. And so, however, Shankaracharya is extremely clear that no doing is involved. It is seeing that is involved and not doing. And so, Acharya is going to answer these questions here. Yeah? But before answering this, he also presents, Bhashyakar also presents another Purvapaksha. So, what do they say? Now go to page 221. Says Anandagiri, the second paragraph, Atmopasanam vidheyam iti pakshamukva pakshantaramaha. Alright, one paksha, one Purvapaksha has been stated, Atmopasanam vidheyam that avasana or knowledge pertaining to atma is something that is subject of vidhi, vidhi vishaya, pakshantaramaha. Now another position, another pura paksha is being stated, apare iti. So paksham number 10, mukti phala shabda shabdam atma jnanam, mukti phala shabdam atma jnanam upasanakyam vedanteshu vidhiyate iti paksham. So what's the new pakshana? Mukti phalam shabdam atma jnanam. Shabdam atma jnanam. Atma jnanam, which is the result of shabda. Mukti phalam, that gives rise to mukti or liberation. Upasana akhyam, that is upasana. Vedanteshu vidhiyate. That in fact Upanishads are giving injunctions pertaining to knowledge. Shabda jnanam, knowledge arising from shabda. Which is called upasana, and that gives rise to the moksha. So they say that the knowledge also is something that is enjoined. What kind of knowledge? That the Pura Pakshi clarifies here, says the then apare varnayanti. So we read that. Apare varnayanti upasanena atma vishayam vishishtam vijnanantaram bhavaye tena atma jnayate avidya nivartakam tadchatadeva na atma vishayam veda vakya janitam vijnanamiti etasmin arthe vachanani api vijnaya prajnam kurvita drashtavya srotavya mantavya nididhyasitavya sovanvishtavya savidignyasitavya ityadini. Apare varnayanti. Other people now say this. Upasanena. Now they have their own meaning of the word upasana. The earlier paksha was, by the word upasana, we mean knowledge, except that knowledge is the vishaya of vidhi. Knowledge is vidhi vishaya. Here on the other hand, the word upasana is understood differently. Upasanena atma vishayam vishishtam vijnanantaram bhavaye. Says vijnanantaram, vishishtam vijnanantaram. There is another kind of a space, another kind of a knowledge. Atma vishayam, there is yet another, over and above the shabdam jnanam. So over and above the knowledge that takes place by listening to the Upanishad, by shravanam, yet another kind of knowledge is required. Tena atma jnayate. It is by some kind of a process that you do inside, by which then some kind of realization takes place. So now you listen to the Upanishad, and there the shabdam jnanam, the knowledge has taken place, and then you perform inside a special kind of meditation, and that meditation generates a new kind of a knowledge. And that, by that knowledge, atma is known. Avidya nivartakam cha tadeva. It is that knowledge which really dispels ignorance, and not merely the knowledge that comes by listening to scriptures. It's all paroksha jnanam. So what you get by listening to, by shravanam, is paroksha jnanam, is only indirect knowledge. But then you must make that knowledge direct or aparoksha by process of meditation. So by the process of meditation, the paroksha jnanam becomes aparoksham. Or there are different ways. All the jnanam that you have gets enhanced in a certain way, and that is how the atma is known. So it is not this, you know, by which you are going to know atma. You must, over and above this, you must do something, some kind of meditation you must perform, by which that knowledge that you have gets transformed into realization, and that is how one realizes Atma. It is that realization that dispels ignorance, and not just the knowledge that comes by listening to the Upanishad. Na Atma Vishayam Vedavakya Janitam Vijnanam Iti. Vedavakya Janitam Vijnanam. The Vijnana of the knowledge that is Vedavakya Janitam, that is generated by the Vedavakya Tattvamasi. So, the knowledge that Mahavakya generates in you is not the knowledge by which it dispels ignorance, but after that knowledge, the meditation that you perform, which generates some apurva, some alaukika, because Vishishtam Vijnanam. So, you don't have words for that knowledge. How will you describe that knowledge? Because if you have described it, then it will come by word. So therefore, that's why words fail everywhere, you know. And then also that knowledge which is generated by the upasana is what will dispel ignorance, and not this knowledge that comes as a result of listening or deliberation upon the Upanishad. Iti is a Puru Paksha. तस्य अनुपयोगमाशंक्याः तेनैति विधेयान्तर विधेयज्ञानान्तरस्य अकिञ्चित्करत्वम् आशंक्या. Somebody said that, what can that upasana do? So he said, तेन आत्मा ज्ञायते. That is that by which atma is known. सिद्धानगी शब्दस्य ज्ञानस्य असंसृष्ट अपरोक्ष आत्मविषयत्वभावम् इति शब्देन हेतु करोति. Now, this is a phenomenal question. What can Shabda do? What can Shabda? Shabda means a statement. What kind of knowledge can it generate? So one paksha is that Shabda or this, you know, Shabda or the word or the sentence state can only generate paroksha jnanam, or it can generate knowledge of a subject or knowledge of an entity which can be related. So, two kinds of sentences have these two aspects. Neelam Utpalam, when we say blue lotus, then you know the lotus as qualified by blueness. So, either words can create knowledge which is Vishishtam, knowledge of an object such as lotus, which is qualified in some way. So, Neelam Utpalam, it is called Vishishtam Jnanam. Knowledge of an object which is qualified. That Shabda can do. Or Dandi Devadatta. So Devadatta is a Dandi. Dandi means one who possesses Danda. So that there is a Sambandha there. Sambandha is what? Devadatta and Danda, both of them are connected or related to each other. So when you say Dandi Devadatta, so then that statement gives you knowledge of Devadatta. Who is Devadatta, meaning an entity who is related to something. So either qualified by something or related to something. So samsarga and vishesha. So vishesha is qualification, samsarga is association. So shabda or the words can only give knowledge of an entity that is in some way qualified by something or related or associated with something. But shabda cannot give you knowledge of an entity which is free from relationship and free from any qualification, because that is the way you describe anything. So whenever you use words, you always describe something. And what you can describe must have jati, kriya, guna, sambandha, etc. So all one of these qualifications must be there, otherwise shabda cannot describe an entity. And therefore, by the very construction of a sentence, the way the sentence actually creates shabda bodha or the knowledge in their mind, it's such that Rama gam anaya. He Rama, you bring a cow. And so, here this gam anaya, all of these words are also connected. And so, gam is an object, anaya is a verb, and ga is the go, the cow is the object of that word, verb. And so only in this manner, when these words are interconnected with one another, then alone a sentence can give you knowledge. So take any sentence, all the words are interconnected. Either words are interconnected, or you can say Shuklam Gam Anaya, Rama Dandena Shuklam Gamana. We bring the white cow. Then Shukla and the Ga are connected. So Go are connected with what? By what we call Visheshana Vishesha. So when you take any sentence, you find that either a word serves the purpose of qualifying something, or the word serves the purpose of generating knowledge in association with other words, but word itself cannot give you knowledge. And so a sentence can only give you knowledge as an associated, you know, of an entity associated with something, or a sentence can give you knowledge of an entity that is qualified by something. But Brahman is associationless. Brahman is unqualified. And therefore, Shabda or a sentence does not have competence even to give you the knowledge of Brahman. This Purupaksha came in Naishkarma Siddhi in the first chapter itself. This point also was brought up there. So, Shabdasya Jnanasya Asamsrishta Aparoksha Atma Vishayatva Abhavam. The Shabda Jnanam, the knowledge generated by Shabda, meaning a sentence, it cannot actually pertain to Brahma, which is Asamsrishta, which is associationless, unconnected, untouched. Aparoksha, with aparoksha meaning, which cannot be objectified, and so Shabda cannot, is not competent to give knowledge of Brahman, which is such and such. Iti iti shabdena hetu karoti na atma visham veda vakya jenna vijnanam iti. That word iti means, because the Shabda cannot actually cannot have its reach in Brahman, and therefore we say that it is not Shabda, it is not the statement of Upanishad that can actually generate knowledge of Brahman. You must do something by which that Shabda Jnanam is transformed into what we call Aparoksha Jnanam. This is a Paksha. And this Paksha is based purely on analyzing what a sentence can do, how Shabda Bodha or how the knowledge takes place by the use of words. And based on that, the words do not have the capability. Yato vacho nivartante aprapya manasasaha. So that from where the words come back along with the thought. So word and the thought, yad vang manasa agocharam. So that which is beyond the reach of words and the mind, and therefore words do not have the capability of giving a knowledge of Brahman. Iti jnanantaram vedanteshu vidhem yatra manamah. And look, Upanishad itself shows that there is jnanantaram. Etasmin arthe vachanani api. Etasmin arthe. So, to convey this particular meaning, vachanani, there are the statements also from the Upanishad. Vijnaya prajnam kurvita. Vijnaya footnote 1. Vijnaya api. Eshu vakyeshu atmopasanam tat sakshatkaram uddishya vidhiyate. So, Eshu Vakyeshu, all these three Vakyas that are quoted here, Atmopasanam Tat Sakshatkaram Uddishyate, the Vidhiyate. So, here there is a Vidhi of the Atmopasanam, meditation upon Atma, Tat Sakshatkaram Uddishya. Keeping in mind the realization of Atma, there is a Vidhi or injunction here of the meditation upon Atma. Tasacha dhiro vijnaya prajnam kurvita. So say the footnote, tasacha dhiraha dhimaan vijnaya atma vijnanaya. Of course their explanation is somewhat different. Vijnaya is vijnanaya prajnam upasanam kurvita iti vakyartha. Actually vijnaya means having known prajnam kurvita. So there are two kinds of things. See what the statement says, vijnaya prajnam kurvita. Vijnaya is what? Is gerund, meaning having known. Prajnam kurvita. Then one should bring about prajna or realization. So having known the Atma by the Upanishads, then one should bring about realization. Shows that realization is a process separate from knowing. Vijnaya, having known. Prajnam kurvita. Prajna is the aparoksha jnanam, the immediate knowledge. So having known the Atma from the Upanishad, then one should realize the Atma. The way the footnote interprets is, Vijnanaya Prajnam Kurvita. Prajna upasanam kurvita iti vakyartha. That for the purpose of knowledge of the Atma, one should perform the upasana or that meditation. Then, drashtavya, shrotavya, mantavya, niridhyasatavya. Here, niridhyasatavya is understood as that meditation, which shrotavya, first listen, mantavya, then reflect upon it. So, having gained the knowledge of shabda by shravana and mananam, niridhyasatavya, then you should meditate upon the Atma, so that knowledge becomes realization. Sa anveshtavya, sa vijignyasatavya ityadini. Atma must be anveshtavya, it must be investigated into, must be inquired into. And then vijignyasatavya, so vijnanam, then again it should be meditated upon, it should be realized. It should be inquired into, and then it should be realized. Chandogya Upanishad says, ityadini. Thus this Purapakshis quote these statements from the Upanishad in support of their position that the Upanishad itself, in fact, enjoins a special kind of knowledge which can be attained only by meditation after the knowledge of the Upanishad. So after the Shabda Bodha, there is a special kind of a knowledge which arises only when you meditate upon the Atma. This is a universal paksha. This is everybody's paksha. Because naturally it just expresses one's frustration that in spite of listening to Upanishad, knowledge has not taken place and therefore something must be done about it. So this expresses the universal frustration. And so, but then again it is Siddhanta Garodhi. Whether one is frustrated or not, whether knowledge has taken place that one thinks it should have taken place. So Siddhanta is that Shabda for the Upanishad is Pramana. That is Siddhanta. And you are questioning that very basis of study of Upanishad. This is called Pramana Vichara. So when we say that Upanishad is Pramana, we look upon the statement of Upanishad as Pramana as a valid means of knowledge, and therefore we carry out this Vichara. We carry out a deliberation upon what is the meaning of those statements. All this would not have been necessary if meditation is going to generate the knowledge, and why study at all? Which also some people say, kya karte ho sab, zarurat nahi hai kuch. And so, now, see the asterisk on the page 221. Anyway, there are some other footnotes also. For example, footnote number 12. Nanu shabdasya manatvat yathavishyam asamsprushta asamsrushta aparokshabodhitvam eshtavyam anyatha amanatvapatrehe. Same question. Says nanu shabdasya manatvat. Wait a minute. You look upon shabdas pramanam. So, vedanto nama upanishad pramanam. So what is vedanta? Is nothing but the Upanishad, which is a pramana. Shabdasya manatvat. See, shabda is, shabda means the statement of the Upanishad, manam, pramanam. Meaning those, pramanam is what? Pramakaranam. That is capable of generating valid knowledge. Prama is what? Yathartha jnanam. So that instrument, that which becomes a means for generating the yathartha jnanam or valid knowledge is called pramanam. And if you look upon Upanishad as pramanam, this body of words which is called statement is what we call Upanishad becomes pramanam. And therefore, the statement of the Upanishad must be looked upon as the means for generating valid knowledge. So, nanu shabdasya manatvat. See, shabda is manam or the pramanam. Yathavishayam. Yathavishayam means in keeping with the object of knowledge. So, jnanam or the knowledge must always be true to the object of knowledge. That's called pramanam. So, therefore, this being pramanam, it should create pramana meaning knowledge of Atma as it is. Asamsrushta aparoksha bodhitvam eshtavyam. And therefore, we have to accept whether it makes sense or not. So now another way of looking at it is this. Either you look at a sentence and see whether a sentence has a capability of giving you the knowledge of Brahman, or you say that Vedanta is pramanam, so it must give you knowledge. So we say that Vedanta is Shabda and Shabda cannot give knowledge. Or you can say Vedanta is Pramana, so Pramana must give knowledge. Somehow it should give knowledge. So say, asam srishta.
says me, this is a Siddhanta, by the way. So here, that Purupaksha is Siddhanta. Asam Srishta Aparoksha Bodhitvam Eshtavyam. Never, we have to accept that the Shabda must be able to give us the knowledge of Brahman, that is Asam Srishta and Aparoksha. Aparoksha means that which is not Paroksha or Pratyaksha, Aparoksha and Asam Srishta, unassociated or associationless. Anyatha Amanatva Patehe. Otherwise, you will accept that Upanishad is not Pramana. If the words or sentences of Upanishads cannot give you knowledge, then they are not Pramana. Iti Asankhya Samahitam Vartike. Purupaksha has Samadhanam for that, of course. And Vartika Gara, for the moment, elaborates that Purupaksha and gives the Samadhanam. Shabdas Svabhava Evaisha Samsrushtarthava Bodhanam. Shabdas Svabhava Evaisha. Esha Shabda Svabhava Eva. This is indeed the Svabhava, or the nature of Shabda, nature of the word, or nature of the sentence. Samsrushta Thavabodhanam. That it can give us Avabodhanam, knowledge of Artha, or knowledge of that entity which is Samsrushta, which is in any some way related. So it can, Shabda can only give us knowledge of something that is related to something else. Brahma Asamsrushta Rupatvat. Since Brahma is Asamsrushta Rupam, meaning Brahma is unassociationless or unrelated. Tena Ataha Navagamyade. Therefore we say that by Shabda, Brahman cannot be known. Because look at Brahman Asamsrushtam. So Shabda cannot give us the knowledge of Brahman. Says the Tika continues. Bahirangartha anusarat antaranga swarupa anusaranam uchitam iti bhavaha. Bahirangartha laukikartha. Now that also is a technical expression. Wherever it comes from. Bahirangartha anusarat. So when you know so much scripture, then you know these expressions occur, you know, in Mimamsa, etc. Bahirangartha anusarat antaranga swarupa anusaranam uchitam. Fortunately, Tikakar himself explains. Bahirangartha laukikartha. Lokehi, some people say that, wait a minute, you cannot apply to Vedic words the kind of criteria you apply to local words. Vedic words are different. So maybe the local words that are used in our day-to-day language, may not be capable of giving knowledge of that entity. But we are talking about Upanishad words, and therefore they should be able to produce, they must have some kind of a uniqueness about them, that they produce knowledge, even though ordinary words and sentences cannot produce. It says, no. Vedic words in the Vedas are also operate in a manner similar to words which operate in a day-to-day manner. That is called Bahiranga means Laukika Artha. In the Laukika, in our day-to-day vyavahara, the manner in which the words function, in the same manner also the Vedic words function, and not in another way. So Lokehi Samsrushtameva Artha Artham Shabdha Bodhayati. So we find that in our Laukika, meaning in our language, etc., in our vyavahara or transaction, the Shabda is able to give the knowledge of an entity that is in some way, as we said, qualified or connected. Therefore, Vedepi Tatha. So Vedic words also should also operate in the same manner. This is a fundamental principle of Mimamsa. Right in the beginning of the Mimamsa Shastra, this is clarified by Jaimini. Said Jaimini that the words of Veda also create the knowledge in a manner similar to the words create knowledge in our day-to-day expressions. Not that the Vedic words, otherwise you can never analyze the Vedic words. They would say, why should I analyze the Vedic words? Because words of Vedas are Vedas. They say, no. Vedic words are also to be analyzed in sentences. And for that analysis, we employ the same criteria that we employ in analyzing the words of literature and whatnot. Because those words also operate in a manner similar to the words in our day-to-day language. Otherwise, the Vedic words are kept in a category above the Laukika words, then there is no way that you can analyze them. If you understand what I mean, because this criteria cannot apply it, and so this is, well, you cannot question. They will generate knowledge somehow, so that somehow is not acceptable to us. You must understand that. So, Mimamsakas are highly devoted to Vedas, but they are very, very practical people.
So they say we must understand the process by which the word creates the knowledge. So we cannot accept some mysterious way that the Vedas in a mysterious way do things. He says no. Vedas are also words. And whichever way the words create knowledge, in that way Vedic words also should create knowledge. This is an accepted principle. And that is what is meant by Bahiranga Arthanusarat Antaranga Swarupa Anusaram. Bahiranga is what? Laukika. Antaranga is Vaidika. So the Vaidika sentences also do the same thing that the Laukika sentences do. Shabdasya samsrushta parokshabodhitve phalitamaha. See, Shabda can only give the knowledge of samsrushta and paroksha. The object is samsrushta and paroksham. Therefore, Brahma asamsrushta rupatvat ataha tena na avagamyade. And therefore, tena shabda jnanena. Since Brahma is asamsrushtam, therefore, by shabda jnana, Brahman cannot be known. This is Purupaksha. Vatikara explains this Purupaksha. As to how Shabda is incapable of giving knowledge of Brahman. Now look at the what we call Kroda Patra. So says, Na Atma Vishyam, you see the asterisk there on the last line of the Bhashya. Na Atma Vishyam Veda Vakya Janitam Vijnanamiti. So that Kroda Patra says, Na Atma Vishyam Veda Vakya Janitam Vijnanamiti Atra Bhashya Pancha Vartikani Santi. To explain that statement of Bhashya, there are five Vartikas. So how brief this Bhashya is, imagine. Even though Bhashya is so elaborate, still it is so brief because just to explain this three words, the Vartikara has written five Vartikas, which require 1500 other verses, you know, to explain, because these Vartikas also require a lot of explanation. So you can see how compact these things are, you know. Atmaname was extremely compact, from that so much discussion came. And every point of discussion requires a lot of other discussion, you know, on the part of Vartikara and then again Tikakara and so on and so forth. So you can see the compactness of the expression here. So how much amount of deliberation Vartikara must have done on the Bhashya to come up with all the ideas that are contained in there, you know. What all Vartikara must have meant when he made a certain statement, all that Vartikara must have deliberated with a lot of Shraddha and Bhakti, you know. So this shows, for you to spend so much time on one word or a few words must really have a tremendous commitment. And that commitment can be there only when there is a tremendous devotion and Shraddha. So, Vartikara would look upon these Vakyas, or his teacher's Vakyas as Pramana. And that is what enables him to commit himself and apply himself with love and reverence to dwell upon that. Only when you have that frame of mind that you can dwell upon them. When you cannot, then you dismiss things. Or just because you can't make out something, so you dismiss it. Then you cannot see what is all contained in that sentence. Anyway, so atra bhashye pancha vartikani santi. There are five vartikas to explain that expression, that passage. Tathai to illustrate. Nahi vakya, so it's all Purupaksha. Vartikara is elaborating the Purupaksha. Nahi vakya samuttena brahma avakya sarupakam vijnanena parichetum shakyade karmavat kvachida. So explanation of this goes to the next page, you know. Again the Kroda Patra, the fourth line. Vakya jnana naiva brahmana siddhatvat kyam vaida jnana antaraniti asankya. So we say, the vakya jnana. Vakya jnana means the jnana generated by vakya. Brahmana siddhatvat. When Vedanta is a pramana, and therefore when Brahman can be known by the knowledge which arises from the Mahavakya, kyam vaida jnana antarana. What's the need for another kind of a special knowledge which you say is enjoined here? Iti asankya, the Purupakshi says, nahi vakya samuttena brahma avakya sarupanam vijnanena parichetum shakyade karmavat vachida. So, vakya samuttena vijnanena avakya sarupakam brahma parichetum na shakyade. So vakya samuttena vijnanena, by the vijnanam that arises from vakya, Brahman which is avakyartha rupakam, Brahman which cannot become the meaning of any particular vakya, parichetam jnatum nashakyate. It is not possible to know Brahman which cannot become the vishaya of any particular vakya, which cannot be confined to the sense that is generated by a vakya, and therefore a vakya cannot give, even mahavakya also cannot give the knowledge of Brahman, which cannot be confined to the sense conveyed by any vakya, because a vakya can only convey limited sense. A vakya can only convey the knowledge of an entity. An entity is always limited. And Brahman, which is limitless, can never be revealed by a vakya, which is only capable of giving us knowledge of something that is limited.
Karma vachita tatra vaidharma dushtantamaha.
Just as karma. Karma can never produce a limitless. Karma being karma is a means which is limited, and therefore what it generates also is only limited. So vakya also is a limited thing. So knowledge that vakya can generate also will be only of an entity that is limited. And Brahma being limitless cannot ever be confined within the confines of vakya. So looking at the vakya, we are saying that it cannot do. Looking at pramanam, you say it can do. Looking at capability of vakya, it is said that it cannot do. And continues.
Kvachit means kvachit deshe kale pumsiva. At no place, at no time, and nobody.
Then, says Tika, vakyo thajnana brahmana aparichcheda hetumaha. Nana padatha samsrishta rupam shabdat prajayate vijnanam tena vakyartha rupam naivachagamyate. Tena vakyartha rupam naivachagamyate. So next verse is Nana padatha samsrishta rupam shabdat prajayate vijnanam. We say that by shabda, the vijnanam or the knowledge that is generated is what? Nana padatha samsrishta rupam. In a sentence there are number of words. At least two words must be there. So sentence has several words, and all the words are interconnected. So knowledge generated by the words that are interconnected also will generate knowledge of an entity that is in some way interconnected. Since words are interconnected, knowledge generated also will be interconnected in your mind. So that's the reason why even when we memorize something, we memorize something in association. What did the first line say? And then how the second line is associated? So by association alone the mind is able to work. And therefore the words always generate knowledge by association. And therefore the knowledge that is generated also is in some way qualified by an association. It's going to have a content of association. And therefore Brahma, which is associationless, cannot ever become the object of the sentence. Cannot be fully revealed by a sentence. Tena avakyartha rupam naiva gamyate. Therefore, Brahman with avakyartha rupam cannot be known by the shabda. Again, the reason is given. Why? Shabda svabhava evaishah samsrushtartha vodhanam brahma samsrushta rupatvat tena to naiva gamyate. We already read that. This Vartika, we just read, because same thing was given in the footnote, that shabda svabhava evaisha, this is the nature of shabda, samsrushtartha vodhanam, that can give the knowledge of an object or an entity that is samsrushta, that is, as we said, interrelated or interconnected. Brahma asamsrushta rupatva, since Brahma is unrelated, ataha tena na avagamyate, therefore, by the words, Brahman cannot be known. Same thing is given in Bahiranga Samsarat Antaranga Surubansaram Uchidami Bhavaha, which we discussed. Shabdasya Samsrishta Parokshabodhita Phalidamaha Brahma Samsrishta Rupatvat Ten Shabdena Jnanena. So, by that word, Brahman cannot, by the knowledge generated by words, Brahman cannot be known. Then Tika continues, Brahma Shabda Jnanam Shabda Jnana Gamyam Atindriyatvat Dharma. We say some other argument. Somebody says, Brahma Shabda Jnanam. We say that Brahman can be known by Shabda. Why? atindriyatvat. Because atindriya, because it is beyond the sense organ. Dharmavada. So just as karmakanda gives us the knowledge of dharma, with atindriya, dharma means punya, papa, all of this is atindriya. They are not perceptible. So we cannot determine really whether a given action will generate punya or papa and so forth. And therefore, dharma, adharma, all of these are known only from Vedas. So dharma, adharma are not something that can be visualized by the mind, and therefore the knowledge of them comes purely from the Vedas. So how the words of the Vedas are able to give us knowledge of dharma, which is nevertheless atindriya or beyond the sense, beyond the reach of the sense organs, and Brahman also atindriyam, it is also beyond the reach of sense organs, and therefore Shabda should be able to give the knowledge, it's Vedic words. Just as Vedas, the Karmakanda section of the Vedas, is able to give us knowledge of dharma, which is beyond the reach of the sense organs, so also the Upanishads, which are also words of Vedas, should be able to give us knowledge of Brahman, which is beyond the reach of the senses, atindriyatvat. So asamskrishta chatrasya rasayat, atindriyatvam. Dharma also is atindriya, Brahma also is atindriya. If the words of the Vedas can give us knowledge of dharma, that is atindriya, why should they not give us knowledge of Brahman, that is atindriyam? Ityasankyaha vakyam cha. So the next verse is, vakyam cha atindriyateshu pramanamati nishchitam. True. That is all right. Mimamsakas want that the dharma must be known from Vedas. Otherwise, if you say dharma also will be known by meditation, then they are in trouble, you know. So vakyam cha atindriyateshu pramanamati nishchitam. Vakyam atindriyateshu pramanamati nishchitam. The vakya is pramana, the means of knowledge, for atindriya dharma, which is atindriya, then vakya is a pramana, it is nishchitam, that is ascertained. Tasyavi avishayatva. But Brahman, we say, is even avishaya, not avishaya of such vakyas, which can give us knowledge of dharma, Brahman is not even avishaya of those vakyas, which can give us knowledge of dharma. Tad-vijñānāntara-gocara-hai. Therefore we say that, tasmāt, therefore Brahman is vijñānāntara-gocara-hai. So Brahman is, can be only known by some vijñānāntaram, some other kind of a vijñānam, other kind of a special knowledge generated by meditation. Say the tika. Yadyapi atindriyārteshu dharmādishu vākyam manam dharmādishu, then so other things apparently, svarga, naraka, etc. You know. So, atindriyateshu. All these atindriyari objects, as is dharma, papa, punya, svarga, naraka and so forth. So, the Vedas are pramana, means of knowledge for all of this. Brahma cha atindriyam. And true, that Brahma also is atindriyam, but tathāpi tasya asamsrushta aparokshasya vākya avishayatvād. But Brahman is atindriyam, all right. That is what they call upādhi. A special factor is involved in Brahman. That Brahma is what? Asamsrushta and aparoksha. Brahman is unassociated and it is not immediate, it's immediate. That being the case, Brahman is different from dharma. And even though Vedavakyas can give us knowledge of dharma, they cannot give us knowledge of Brahman. Because Brahman is in a class different from dharma. Jnanantara gocharata, therefore we say that Brahman can only be known by some special knowledge generated by meditation. Tena cha avidyana vrittihi na shabda jnana nityartha. And therefore, it is not shabda jnanam that can dispel ignorance. It is a special knowledge that can dispel ignorance. Taditi asamsrushta aparoksham brahma uchyate. Tad vijnana antara gochara. That Brahman is vijnana antara gochara, is can only be known through some special knowledge. Now, this raises a serious question. Say the Tika, Brahmanaha ved agamyatve. Now, all you are saying is, Brahman is Upanishad agamyam. All you are saying, Purapakshi, is that Brahman cannot be known by the words of Upanishad. Meaning, Brahman is ved agamyam. Cannot be known even by the Vedas, from what you are saying. Tadarthatva ayogat aupanishadatva visheshanam anavakasham. And so, Veda agamyatve, Since Brahman cannot be known by Veda, Tadarsattva Ayogat. Therefore, Brahman cannot be Vedasattva, meaning Brahman cannot be known by the Vedas. Aupanishadattva Visheshanam Avakanavakasam Tvamtu Aupanishadam Purusham Veda. So, you do know that Aupanishad Purusha, the Paramatma known only from Upanishad. Aupanishad means what? Upanishad Ekagamya. That which can be only known by Upanishad is called Aupanishad. So, Brihadaranyaka Upanishad itself uses the expression Aupanishad to describe Atma. So, when we say that Atma is that which can only be known through Upanishad, that is called Upanishad, all of those expressions will become meaningless if from what you argue, Atma can be known from Upanishad. And Upanishad will lose its pramanyam. Ishankare nache. So, Shankar is also answered. Says the verse in Vartika, nache vakyotha vijnana parichedyam tadishave nam nayartho bhavetarhi naivam vedasa evahiti. Says, if you say, Purupakshi says, nached vakyotha vijnana parichedyam tad brahma ishade. So we say that if Brahman cannot be vakyotha vijnana parichedyam, parichedyam is name. If Brahman cannot be known by the knowledge generated from vakya, na amnayartha bhavetarhi. In that case, Brahman cannot become that which is known by amnaya by the Vedas. So Brahman will not be then known from Veda. That's what it amounts to. See, when you are saying all this, that after listening to this, you must do something else. Then listening becomes minor, that doing becomes major. This becomes anga, that becomes angi. In which case, what purpose does it serve other than giving information? Then it becomes a roadmap, just gives you information. So that means Upanishad gives you information and then you must do something in order to make realize it. That means that Upanishad is not the pramanam. And Veda is not only revealed by Upanishad, is revealed by meditation, that's some special knowledge, and not by the Upanishad. In which case, Upanishad will lose, you know, their meaning. Upanishad will become redundant. Says, well, tarhi naivam, no, we don't say that, Purupakshi says. Actually, you see, the way you read that Vartika is, tarhi naivam vedasa eva, I mean, you can also say, maybe all right, say that it's not vedasa, but not, that's not the way to read it. Tarhi naivam, comma, vedasa eva hi. We say that, if you say tarhi, then, no, what you say is not right, vedasa eva hi. Still it is vedasa. We say that still, Brahman is known through the Vedas. Vedas still become the instrument in making us know Brahman. How? That we have to understand. Says the Tika, the last line, last button. Veda vihita upayajanya jnanagamyatvat vedasadayati aupanishadattvam aviruddham. Vijnaya prajnam kurvita. Upanishad itself says, having known Brahman from the Upanishad, then prajnam kurvita, then you must get that special knowledge. So Upanishad is directing us. Atmanam eva upasita. So you must meditate upon Atma. Therefore, Upanishad itself is directing us to that process. In that sense, since Upanishad itself directs us to that process of special knowledge, therefore we say that Upanishad becomes is a means for the knowledge. Even though the words of Upanishad do not directly give you knowledge, and as much as Upanishad itself enjoins that special meditation, so on account of enjoining the special meditation, Upanishad becomes an instrument of knowledge. So still Brahman is known by Upanishad. Brahman is known by the method which is told to us by Upanishad. So Brahman is not known by the words of Upanishad directly, but Brahman is known by the means that is revealed to us by Upanishad, namely the special meditation. This is the Purupaksha. Naivam. Naivam, then what? Vedasa evahi. No, it is Vedasa. Vashyakara does not reply this Purupaksha right away. So all these things that is in our mind has to wait. Because two pakshas are presented. That's not the usually one paksha will present an answer and second paksha an answer. Why should we lump together these two? But anyway, that's what is done here. So two separate pakshas are being first presented and then first paksha is answered. So all that you have discussed which is in our mind All has to be set aside. And now our mind must be tuned to the first Pura Paksha. The Upasita, you know. Upasita means that Upanishad gives us the vidhi of knowledge. They don't say that Upasita means some kind of a meditation. They say that Veda and Upasita, both of them mean the same. Therefore, the knowledge is something that is enjoined by Upanishad. Even that is not acceptable to us. Knowledge cannot be an object of instruction. Knowledge is something that takes place. So when the object of knowledge is, and when the instrument of knowledge is, the knowledge takes place because knowledge is Rastu Tantram and not Purusha Tantram. Vidhi always requires Purusha Tantratvam. Vidhi means injunction or instruction. Instructions will only serve the purpose when the one who is instructed has a freedom to do that. Or freedom not to do that also. But in case of knowledge, one does not have the freedom. Knowledge takes place. I do not have the freedom for the knowledge not to take place. When I look at you, the knowledge, the perceptual knowledge of the people sitting in front of me will take place. If I keep my eyes open and there are people sitting in front of me, I do not have a choice in not knowing them, not perceiving them, because the perception will take place. Which is a big problem sometimes. I wish I had not heard this. Sometimes we say, but the ears are there, the shabda words are there, you will hear, what can you do about it? Unless you plug your ears. As long as ears are open, you hear. As eyes are open, I wish I had not seen these things. Sometimes you say, but then you have no choice because when the eyes are open and things are happening, you will see them. So idea is that as far as knowledge is concerned, there is no choice. So the first Pura Paksha is, knowledge is something that is enjoined by the Upanishad because they just want to classify, categorize Upanishad also. They want to lump Upanishad along with Karmakanda. And they say that Vedas, the primary statement of Vedas, are the nature of Vidhi and Nisheda, or Vidhi. Nisheda also is a kind of Vidhi. So Vidhi and Nisheda are the primary statements. Instructions is the primary role that Vedas plays. And not just revealing something. Just to give us information is not the role of Vedas, because information you can obtain yourself. If things are there in the world, you can yourself get the information. What does Veda do? But Vedas tell you what to do with that information. Because human being is limited in every way. His jnana shakti, all the ability to know is limited. And therefore, he does not know what is good for him and what is bad for him because he has a very narrow or a constricted perception of life. And therefore, he cannot take into account all the factors that are involved really in determining the result. Therefore, he must be told what to do and what not to do. And that only by doing something that you can accomplish something that you don't have. That you find yourself unhappy and bound and limited, and therefore you must do something to become happy and become free. And what should you do? There is no way that you know about it. And therefore, Vedas instruct you as to what you should do in order to become free. In this case, we say that the Vedas are giving an instruction on knowledge of the Atma, but that knowledge will be again meditation, because if you do something in terms of knowledge, that knowledge only will amount to meditation. Therefore, he says that Upanishads also enjoin meditation upon the Atma, that it is by the meditation upon the Atma then one gets liberated. So, in that sense, the two pakshas are not too different from each other. Both of them are talking about meditation, except first paksha says that there is only meditation, and second paksha says that there is Shabda Jnanam and meditation. So, in that sense, the two pakshas are somewhat different. But in as much as both of them say that meditation upon Atma is enjoined, that moksha is a result of meditation. Here, the Karmakandis, Mimamsakas would say that meditation will produce, meditation is a manasam karma, is an act, is an action. Action always produces a result, and moksha is a result. The second paksha says meditation creates some apurva, well, again that also. And then somehow the knowledge takes place. Somehow the knowledge of Atma takes place. then it becomes mystical. When somehow comes, it becomes mysterious or mystical. Then you leave it to whatever factors, you know, for the knowledge to take place. Something will happen. And so, in fact, in that sense, both the Purvapakshas are saying that you have to do something in order for moksha to take place. In order for, in first case, moksha to take place, in second place, for knowledge to take place. The Vedanta Siddhanta is what? That Shabda gives aparoksha jnanam. Vedanta Siddhanta means the Siddhanta that we are discussing here is that Shabda gives aparoksha jnanam. So now, page 222 says Anandagiri, Pakshadvaya Prapte Prathama Paksham Pratyaha. Pakshadvaya Prapte, two Pakshas are there. One is which Upasita is a vidhi pertaining to Upasana or meditation. Second is Upasita is a vidhi of some kind of a knowledge that is generated after the Shabda Jnanam. And so of these two Pakshas, says the footnote number 2, Shabdam Jnanam Vidheyam Upasanikam Va Jnanantaram Vidhi Pakshadvayam. Shabda Jnanam is Vidheyam, that you must do something. Jnana is an object of vidhi, the first paksha says. Second paksha says that you perform the upasana with another kind of a jnana. Upasana is jnanantaram. Another kind of a jnana is required. Of that, the first paksha is being answered here. Na iti, says Bhashyakara. Na arthantara abhavat na cha आत्मेत्येवोपासिता इति अपूर्वविधिः कस्मात् आत्मस्वरूपकथन अनात्मप्रतिषेधवाक्यजनित विज्ञानव्यतिरेकेण अर्थान्तरस्य कर्तव्यस्य मानसस्य बाह्यस्य वा अभावात् न अर्थान्तर अभावात् इज न मीनिंग दिस इज प्रतिज्ञा इज न दैट्स नॉट राइट व्हाट यू से दैट उपासिता इज द विधि पर्टेनिंग टू नॉलेज दैट इज It means that Atma is to be meditated upon is not right. Why? Arthantar abhavat. Arthantar is what? Kartavyantar abhavat. Because other than the knowledge, there is nothing that remains to be done. If something remains to be done after gaining the knowledge, then alone the vidhi has a purpose to serve, as Bhashyakara will explain. See, interesting thing is, when you give vidhi, that also gives the knowledge actually. Satyam vada, dharmam chara, himsam na kuriya, these are the vidhinishita vakya. So when it says satyam vada, what does it do? It gives you knowledge that you should speak truth. Dharmam chara, you must perform your dharma. So these vakyas also give knowledge. Then what happens is, that knowledge generates in you a further deliberation. They say, hey, speak truth, so I must speak truth. Or dharmam chara, that I must follow my duty, or I must follow my dharma, then that actually, then that generates what? Again a prerana. So that generates in you again this idea that I must do something. And that's how the action follows after the knowledge. For example, it says, so, jyotishtomena swarga kamo yajeta, the one who is desirous of swarga, should perform Jyotishtoma Yaga. It's just information. This is only knowledge that Jyotishtoma is a means for attainment of Swarga. But inasmuch as there is in me a desire for Swarga, therefore I am inspired to perform that Jyotishtoma Yaga because it is a means of Swarga. Therefore, first the knowledge is generated by the Vidhi and that is followed by action. So only that kind of... So what is called Vidhi Vakya? Is that vakya which generates a knowledge, which creates in you an inspiration for action. So two kinds of knowledge are there. One kind of knowledge is that which creates in you an inspiration or motivation to do something. Says, oh, you know, Swamiji has come. That's the knowledge or information. Then motivation. I want to go and see him. Or I want to go and hear him. And listen to him. So, that's one thing. Or, this is Swamiji. Suppose somebody is introduced, then this is Swamiji. Then you know it. In that case, no further, there is no motivation to do anything. So this is a kind of knowledge which reveals the nature of things which are present, that does not require any need to do something. So two kinds of knowledges are there. Veda also produces two kinds of knowledge. In Karmakanda section, Veda produces knowledge of the things which motivate us to do something. In Upanishad, the Vedas produce knowledge which just reveal the nature of things, which even bring about a cessation of doing something. Oh, this is Swamiji. Oh, thanks for telling me. We're also going to go to see him. You know, sometimes what happens is, you want to meet somebody. Swamiji was in fact describing his own experience. An old English man was there. I don't remember his name. So I don't know what was his name. Some Murphy or some whoever he must be. So, in fact, he attended part of our course, you know. So when that man first came to India, he must have been traveling. He must have heard about Swami Dayananda. And he had heard that Swami Dayananda was going to give talks in Simla or someplace, you know. So this man was traveling in a plane, you know, to Simla. I assume that plane goes to Simla, you know, or some place where the plane goes. He was traveling, you know, in the aeroplane. Maybe Rishikesh, all right. And so, then he asked, then some passenger was sitting beside him, and he asked, so where are you going? So I'm going to Rishikesh. This other passenger said, oh, do you know Swami Dayananda? Says, why? I'm going to see Swami Dayananda to Rishikesh. I am Swami Dayananda. Soyam Dayananda. Instead of Soyam Devadatta, he used to present this example. Soyam Dayananda. This is Dayananda. So, there's no need to go anywhere now. So, this is a knowledge that brings about a cessation of doing something, because what he wanted to do, he wanted to meet Swamiji, that already is accomplished by this knowledge, and therefore, that any activity which would have been generated to meet him, that activity has come to a cessation. So there is one kind of knowledge that in fact brings about a cessation of activity. There is another kind of knowledge that motivates action. So, have you heard Swamiji is in Coimbatore? Okay, then let us go there. Then you travel and do all kinds of things. So there is one kind of knowledge which, these are things that we know, we should know, because this is a day-to-day thing. In life also, two kinds of knowledges are there. One kind of knowledge that motivates an action. Majority of the knowledge falls in this category. But some rare sentences are there, like Krom Dashamosi is a knowledge that actually brings about a cessation of activity, because there's no need now to search for the tenth man. And therefore, hey, the tenth man is behind that hill. That knowledge will generate an activity. You are the tenth man, that knowledge will bring about a cessation of activity. What kind of knowledge does the Upanishad give? Mimamsa Karma say, they give first kind of knowledge, because that's the only knowledge that they accept. They say that the knowledge is information. They would call knowledge of an existing entity as an information. Doesn't do anything. Only when you know something that you did not know so far, or you're looking for, that will generate the activity. We are saying that Upanishads give the knowledge, but do not motivate activity. So understand that Vidhivakya also is a Vakya, and what we call Mahavakya also is a Vakya. Both are Vakyas of the Vedas. But why do you call those Vidhivakyas? And why do you call these the Mahavakyas of generating knowledge? We call them Vidhivakyas because those Vakyas give the kind of knowledge which motivate action. And these are called Mahavakyas, Vyasana. They call them also Mahavakyas. But let's say these are Upanishad Vakyas, which actually bring about a cessation of activity. So we say that Upasita could be qualified as Vidhivakya, provided Upasita motivated an activity. If this Upasita, as stated here, If it brought about, it motivated an activity for you to do something, then it would be called a vidhi. But if on the other hand it brings about a cessation of activity, it is not vidhi, then it is what? It is the mahavakya generating knowledge. So what kind of a vakya is this? Atmasmat atmanameva upasita. One should meditate only upon the atma. That meditation of knowledge, as we said, does it generate an activity? The answer is no. So it would be called vidhivakya if it followed, it motivated an activity. This does not motivate the activity, therefore this is not vidhivakya. Don't go by grammar only. Let us see what the vakya does. Going to the heart of the thing. Not confining to the grammar and structure and things like that, but going to the heart of the things. It says, na arthantar abhavat. Arthantar kartavyantar abhavat. Having, after listening to Upanishad, no kartavya remains. All kartavya comes to an, if you understand that. If you understand what the Upanishad says, praptasya praptihi, attainment already attained, what kartavya remains? No kartavya remains at all. So, ko vidhi, ko nishedha. Where is vidhi and nishedha? When you come to realize that you are what you are looking for. And therefore, there is vidhi and nishedha. Do not have a scope in knowledge of this type. This is what Bhashyakara says. Na arthantar abhavat, kartavyantar abhavat. There is no kartavyantar. Anyam kartavyam, kartavyantaram. Another thing to do. There is no another thing to do after listening to or after knowing what the Upanishad says. Nacha atmetyo upasita. So says Tikakara, tatra nayartameva svayam vyachaste. Tatra means pratijna hetu bhagayoho madhye. There are two. Na is pratijna, arthantara bhava hetu. Of the two, the pratijna. What is the pratijna? Is what Bhashyakara first explains. Nacha atmetyo upasita de apurva vidhi. What's the meaning of the word na? Na arthantara bhavat. What is the meaning of word na? Bhashyakara himself says, na means na cha atmetyevopasita iti apurva vidhi. That the statement atma alone should be meditated upon is not a vidhi, apurva vidhi. Says Anandagiri, shabda jnanavataha vishaya abhavat na vidhi sambhavati avidya tatkarya nivrittau svayam phalavastatvat chaityardaha. Shabda jnanavataha vishaya abhavat means anushteya abhavat, fourth footnote. For the one who has gained the knowledge of the shabda, then nothing remains to be anushteya, nothing remains to be accomplished, or nothing remains to be done. Anushteya is that which should be performed. Like yaga is called anushteya, brahma is not anushteya. When you get the, when Vedas reveal the knowledge of yaga, the yaga is something that you should do something about to get the result. But when the Upanishads reveal Brahma, Brahma is not something you can do something about. And the Brahma is, does not fall in the category of anushteya, something to be performed. Na vidhi sambhavati. And therefore, shabda jnanavataha, for the one who possesses shabda jnanam, since nothing remains to be done, this cannot be vidhi. Avidya tatkarya nivrittau. When, as a result of the listening to the statements, when avidya, ignorance, and avidya, karya, all the notions generate from ignorance, nivrittau, when that is spent. And we know, to the extent that we understand the knowledge, the notions are being dispelled. That's what the knowledge does. As we even expose ourselves to this day in and day out, how long, Swamiji? I don't know how long as necessary. Because every day we hear, hopefully, some notion is being dispelled, you know. That's exactly what this does, is dispels the notion. And that is avidya karyam. Avidya or ignorance only manifests itself in the form of notions. And thus dispelling notions. And as you understand, as you hear, you understand. As you understand, the notion is dispelled. That's what it is. So avidya tatkarya nivrittau svayam phalavastatvacha. So dispelling notion itself is freedom. What else is freedom? If that after dispelling all notions again freedom is to be obtained, if the freedom is that, then it's different. But what freedom are we seeking? We are seeking freedom from notion, that's all we are seeking. All kinds of complexes, that's what we are seeking freedom from. And the complexes are dispelled by listening to Upanishad, by listening to the nature of reality, that's all. So by not knowing reality and having a distorted perception of reality, all kinds of complexes about myself and about the world are created. World is such and such, this fellow is such and such, and you know, and then raga dveshas are created. All of this is created because of not knowing the nature of reality about myself and about the world. And as that just dawns on me, as it becomes clear to me, the notions of the complex is generated, what we call misconceptions or misapprehensions created because of wrong understanding of reality, they get dispelled. And all the passions generated from those notions, they are all, raga dveshas are all passions, all generated from distorted, wrong understanding or notions. As the notions go, those passions also go. And that is the freedom. Freedom from passion, that's what it is. Passion not in terms of love, passion in terms of raga, dresha, kama, krodha, moha, madha, matsarya. Very powerful stuff. And that poor love has nowhere to see. There is love alone. The original nature of love alone becomes all this stuff. Kama, krodha, loha, moha, are nothing but distorted expressions of love. All we want to do in our life is make that love pure, that's all. Make it free from the distortion. So love also, you don't have to go and beg anywhere. It's there. The very passion shows of any kind, shows nothing but love. Even anger also shows nothing but love. I'm angry at something because I'm deprived of something that I love, or so I think. And therefore, every expression of every passion is nothing but expression of love, which is the nature of Atman. And all that we seek to do is release that love from all these distortions. That's all. Enjoy the pure love. That's what we call freedom. We don't want to fly up and down or anywhere. We don't want any accomplishment. Love is already accomplished. And all that we want to do is to just release it. And how? Who has bound it? Who has tied it? All the distortions and notions have tied it. You blame your father for it and mother for it and whoever you want to blame for him, keep on blaming them. After blame is over and you understood that all these fellows are responsible for my problems, you have to still solve the problem and you have to solve it, understand? It may give you satisfaction to know that somebody else is responsible for my problem and not I, all right. But we say, Avidya is responsible, why worry, you know? Who is responsible for all the evils in life? Ignorance. And so mother also is ignorant. And therefore, primordial ignorance is the cause of every problem. So why worry about tracing the source of this stuff? I don't say you should not trace, but ultimately you have to resolve it anyway. You will understand that it is not a person who is responsible, it is ignorance that is responsible. The person is called responsible, then what shall I do with that person? I can't change that person. I can't get rid of that person. And suppose physically the person is gotten rid of, I can't get rid of it in my mind. And so, the process of all these psychological analysis is fine, except that process must be pursued until we understand that it is ignorance that is the problem. Then I would say that we have pursued that process properly. Otherwise, if you stop that process and stop at a thing, we consider something else as a problem other than ignorance, know that you have not pursued that process completely. Father, mother, son, daughter, friend, society, communism, British people, Muslims, whoever are the problems. Or Gandhiji, or Jawaharlal Nehru, or Nehru family, whoever is the problem. All these problems will ultimately trace to ignorance, that's all. Whose ignorance? My own ignorance. Because if I did not have ignorance, none of these things can be a problem. When can I be affected? When I am vulnerable. And so I am vulnerable because I am ignorant. Not only am I ignorant, I have all kinds of notions generated from ignorance. That's what makes me vulnerable. When you expose your film, when will the picture take place? Only when the film is coated with chemical coating. If you stuff your camera with a plain paper, no amount of exposure is going to create any impression on that. Today, every exposure to the world creates impact on me because vulnerability is right there. When once that goes, so that's where it is to be removed. It is not the exposure to the world which is the problem. It is vulnerability which is there in me, which is a product of ignorance. That is the problem. That is what is said here, you know. Shankaracharya says all these things, then in his own way. In his own way when he is saying, so prapta, whatever he says, you know, this all amounts to this. That ultimately ignorance. So avidya, they don't talk of anything else. Avidya, tatkara nivrittau. So avidya kara nivrittau, not that you get rid of some person and some situation, which you might want to do for the purpose of relief, you know, that's okay. So in the life we require some relief, we require, you know, some respite. So you have an air conditioner, all that respite from this heat, no problem, no grudge against it. You want to go away to Rishikesh for a while, no problem, everything is fine. Suchau deshe pratishthapya or vivikta deshe sevitam, everything is fine. But ultimately it is my vulnerability that is to be eliminated, and all those things can become helpful. And when my vulnerability is removed, then alone I can be happy and not otherwise. And that vulnerability arises from avidya, from ignorance. Avidya tatkara nivrittau svayam phalavastatvaccha. And then nivritti itself is phalam. You don't need anything further. Svayam phalavastatvaccha. Says footnote number 5. Phalavastatvaccha evi mumukshoho ishtam pumartharupam yat kaivalyam brahma tasya tat sarupatvat. Mumukshoho ishtam pumartharupam yat kaivalyam brahma. Mumukshu, what mumukshu desires? And what is it? Pumartharupam, that will fulfill his purushartha. Yat kaivalyam brahma, that brahma is kaivalyam, pure. If you want to translate word brahma as love, you are welcome to do that. Because there's a whole tradition called Christianity only talks of love. In India also, the whole tradition of bhakti only talks of love. Don't think that is different. Aapka brahma aisa vaisa, brahma means love. So don't think that brahma is something different from love and bhakti. No, but it is saguna nirguna. What? Love is always nirguna. Love is always unconditional. Moment they add a condition, it gets qualified. Or we seek unconditional love. We seek to free that love from all conditions. Then alone that can be released. It's all right. Then we require some condition, as I said, to get away from some other conditions. And therefore, saguna, sakara, all of those conditions are fine. So that my love can get a certain expression, because I am so fed up with other akaras and gunas that I need specific akara gunas, all fine. Ultimately, love has to be released from every kind of a condition. But we use certain conditions, understand? We seek to become free from conditions through conditions. That is the cleverness of our tradition. All the traditions dismissed all kind of conditions. Says, no, you cannot think of God who is any kind of form, you know. So destroy it. Now that is all stupid. They don't understand the human need. So we want to become free from conditions through special conditions. Just as in a world pole, you use the pole in order to become free from that pole, but that is required to lift yourself up to that point and then you drop it. So also all saguna, all akaras and forms, all forms of devotions and action, all of that definitely is helpful in order to lift us up, you know, from all kinds of bondage, all kinds of notions and restrictions that we have. Ultimately, we seek to drop. And that will happen, of course. But the idea is that even if Brahma is transcended as love, when we say Brahma is unconditional or beyond conditions, love in its true nature also does not admit of any condition. Therefore, someone like Jesus Christ or Lord Krishna can love anybody. You can't love all those fellows, I mean, that they used to love. We can love if somebody looks good, is dressed well, he talks properly, then I can love. No such condition. Whether it's Kubja is there, or whoever are there, all of them can be loved, because no condition at all. So even though Lord Krishna is a form, he represents the formless. Even though, you know, This very process of manifestation of love represents the love without any condition. So you can love an action of stealing, no problem for him. He can steal with love, and so even the act of stealing will not create any kind of a reaction from others because they sense love even there also. So any action, because love being unconditional, can mean anything, you know. Anyway, I mean, so yet kaivalyam brahma, kaivalyam means that is unconditional, that's what kaivalyam is. Tasya tat swarupatvat, tasya brahmanah tat mumukshu swarupatvat. Since brahma, which is such, is mumukshu swarupam, is the very nature of the mumukshu, therefore. Ajnana matra vyavahitatvat, then what separates me from that love, or what separates me from Brahman? Ajnana matra vyavahitatvat. Since I have all kinds of notion of what love is, since I always have I always visualize love as certain condition. If such and such thing is done, then it is called love. If something else is done, it is not called love. Since I have my own picture of what love is, that is why I am separated from love, which is my own nature, because I always seek love in a certain condition. That is another word for happiness. Happiness also, which is what Vedanta uses. So ananda, happiness, I always associate with a certain condition of time, place or configuration. So since I have in my own way confined that happiness or love in a certain configuration, I am seeking that configuration, confusing that with love. Then I am always seeking configuration, always different from me. Configuration being changing, therefore I find that no configuration is ever adequate, and I'm always a seeker. Ajnana vyavahitatva, ajnana matra vyavahitatva. Since vyavadhanam, or that separation, or that interference, interruption, is only because of the ajnana. Jnana devatanam vruttehe, and therefore, that ignorance can only be dispelled by knowledge, because it is ignorance that alone may create in me a sense that love that I'm seeking is separate from me. Tascha vakya janyatvena, and that knowledge about the self can only be generated by vakya, by making me see, the nature of myself. Vidhi anadhinatvad anusthaya abhavad, and therefore there is no vidhi as far as knowledge is concerned, because knowledge is that knowledge of the siddha vastu is generated by vakya. Anusthaya abhavad, there is no anusthaya, there is nothing that is to be done. Vidhi asiddhehe vedanteshu taduktihi ayukta iti bhavaha. Vidhi asiddhehe, therefore, you cannot establish a case of vidhi. Vidhi doesn't have a room here. Vedanteshu taduktihi, therefore to say that in Vedanta also there is vidhi upasita iti ayukta. To interpret the Vedantic statements as vidhi vakyas is not proper. And so the Tika said, Shabda jnanavataha vishaya abhavat, meaning anushtheya abhavat, na vidhis sambhavati, therefore there is no sambhavana or possibility or case of